Six Flags Magic Mountain is a world-renowned amusement park located in Valencia, California. Known as the thrill capital of the world, it boasts a collection of roller coasters that cater to thrill seekers and families alike. Since its debut in 1971, the park has continuously expanded and evolved, with many attractions relocated, renovated, or removed altogether. Journey back in time to discover the story of these now lost rides. One of the shortest-lived roller coasters at Six Flags Magic Mountain, Shockwave only operated at the park for three seasons. Opening on May 16, 1986, the ride was a stand-up roller coaster for manufacturer Intamin. It was the first stand-up coaster the company had produced, and at the time was the longest and fastest stand-up ride in the world. Shockwave was installed at the very back of the park, in Spillikin Handcrafters Junction, and replaced the Sarajevo bobsleds that had originally occupied the plot. The coaster's jet black track and supports were complemented by bright red trains. Riders would board one of the two trains that accommodated 20 riders in five rows. Restraints were over the shoulder, with one half fixed and the other half ratcheting downwards. Immediately out of the station, trains would climb a 90-foot lift hill. At the top, riders entered a curved drop, twisting 180 degrees and lining up with a vertical loop. Following this, trains would rise into a bank curve, dropping once more and negotiating a bunny hill. Another curve would offer a brief pause during the mid-course breaks. Dropping off the brakes, the rest of the layout consisted of bank curves and helixes as the train eventually made its way back to the station. The installation of Shockwave was a runaway success. Magic Mountain saw an 18% increase on attendance compared to the prior year, justifying the ride's $3.5 million price tag. Despite the strong reception, Shockwave would close at the end of 1988. The roller coaster would become part of Six Flags' ride rotation program. This initiative saw a number of rides relocated to different parks within the chain. It was a way of introducing a new attraction to its parks every year without a large capital investment. For 1990, Shockwave opened at Six Flags Great Adventure. It would operate there for three seasons before being dismantled and relocated to Six Flags Astroworld for 1993. It received a new black and yellow colour scheme to fit with its name, Batman the Escape. Astroworld would close for good at the end of 2005, after 37 years of operation. Some of its rides would be relocated to other parks. Batman was dismantled and shipped to Darien Lake, where it was placed in storage. The repeated relocation of roller coasters as part of the ride rotation programme led to increased roughness with each installation. This could be one of the reasons why the original Shockwave was never again installed and opened. An opening day attraction, Eagle's Flight, was a gondola lift that would transport guests around Magic Mountain. Featuring three stations, Eagle's Flight would carry guests up and over the large mountain at the centre of the new amusement park. Designed by Intamin, the gondola lift featured the square bucket-shaped cars that were common in similar attractions installed during that time period. Riders could board the Galaxy Station close to the Galaxy Ride, or the El Dorado Station at the rear of the park. The two stations at the base of the mountain would connect to the dual Shangri-La station atop Samurai Summit. It was a one-way ride and four people could squeeze into each vehicle. The ride on Eagle's Flight would offer spectacular views across the park, as in the early years foliage and landscaping had yet to grow in. The ride towered over the peak it traversed, with the concrete towers that supported the galaxy legs seemingly unfeasibly tall. The attraction had rules that prohibited the swinging of the gondolas, but this was often ignored, with a tragic accident occurring in February 1978. A pair of newlyweds had been violently rocking their car as it travelled on the El Dorado route. Their bucket slipped from the cable and dropped 50 feet to the ground. The 23-year-old man was killed, with his wife suffering critical injuries. Following this incident, the ride was redesigned and the El Dorado leg was closed permanently in 1981. The remaining route would continue to operate, but would not reopen following the Northridge earthquake on January 17, 1994. The concrete towers would be removed to make way for Superman the Escape, which opened in 1997. The Shangri-La station is the only remaining part of Eagle's Flight and can still be seen on Samurai Summit. The restrooms and patio remain open to the public, while the remaining portions of the building have occasionally been used to house Fright Fest mazes. Introduced for 1992 was Flashback, This compact roller coaster was located just off Six Flags Plaza, the main entrance area. Flashback was not a new ride and had previously operated at two other parks as part of the Six Flags ride rotation program. Originally, the ride opened as Z-Force at Six Flags Great America in 1985. Z-Force was a new style of coaster from Intamin. The Space Diver model was designed to be mass-produced, and its layout consisted of a number of diving hairpin turns arranged vertically. The design was worked on by Claude Mabillard and Walter Bollinger and would feature hallmarks of their future work. The track utilised a square box section spine that could accommodate four across trains articulated to make the compact turns possible. The ride itself was in fact the prototype. They had originally operated at the Intamin testing facility. Z-Force operated at Great America until mid-1985, when it was removed before being reinstalled at Six Flags Over Georgia for 1988. It would operate there for four seasons, closing in 1991 and being transferred to California to be installed at Magic Mountain as Flashback. The compact design of the ride managed to contain 1,900 feet of track, stacked vertically. The coaster featured a blue and white colour scheme, but by the time it arrived at Magic Mountain, it was already showing signs of wear. The four across trains featured fiberglass seats and featured a lap bar and hard over-the-shoulder restraints. A lift hill would raise trains to the highest point, where they circled almost the full ride before entering the first dive. The drops were quite severe, with unusual banking, and created a free-falling sensation. Flashback featured six of these dives over its layout, but only reached a top speed of 35 miles per hour. In 1995, Six Flags opened the Hurricane Harbor Water Park adjacent to Flashback's plot, and almost immediately visitors and staff complained about the noise from the coaster. The sound of trains negotiating the track was distracting to lifeguards and didn't make for a relaxing experience at the water park. To rectify this, Magic Mountain would not operate Flashback while Hurricane Harbor was open, meaning the ride was not in operation at the busiest times of year. The last rides would take place in 2003, and the coaster was standing but not operating until 2007, when it was dismantled and scrapped. The Space Diver model, while intended for mass production, only saw this one ride ever constructed. Claude Mabillard and Walter Bollinger, however, would go on to found their own company, perfecting the box section and train design and producing some of the most celebrated roller coasters around the world. Looking to fill the plot vacated by Shockwave a few years earlier, Cyclone was introduced for 1991. This wooden roller coaster sat at the very back of the park and brought a new theme to the area that was christened Cyclone Bay. The attraction's installation followed the construction of the Georgia Cyclone at Six Flags Over Georgia the prior year. The company again hired Curtis D. Summers and the DIN Corporation to design and install the new coaster, with a layout based on the original Cyclone at Coney Island. The Georgia Cyclone had caused numerous injuries since its debut, and Six Flags had asked for gentler profiling for the Magic Mountain version. The ride was constructed out of unpainted southern yellow pine and opened on March 23, 1991. The surrounding area featured a light nautical theme to match the new coaster, and the park advertised Cyclone as the ultimate mind bender. In the station, riders would board one of the two trains, secured by a lap bar. Trains were manufactured by Bollinger and Mabillard, which were the only wooden roller coaster trains ever produced by the company. The coaster would start with a curved tunnel out of the station and enter the 95-foot lift hill. At the top, riders immediately entered the first drop, racing downwards and reaching a top speed of 50 miles per hour. A 180-degree bank curve led to the second drop, pulling upward into a hill before dropping again and climbing for another turnaround. The coaster then undulated alongside the lift, riders rising and falling before changing direction and passing through the wooden structure of the ride itself. Two more turns would be negotiated as trains threaded themselves through the supports before eventually reaching the brakes. Problems soon plagued the new roller coaster, and riders complained of excessive discomfort. The B&M trains were heavier than traditional roller coaster trains and took their toll on the track. In 1994, Cyclone would suffer structural damage from the Northridge earthquake, and modifications were made. This included trim brakes that slowed the train to a crawl during the turnaround sections. As part of this, Trains required a minimum of 17 passengers to dispatch in order to prevent a stall. The reduced popularity and out-of-the-way location resulted in trains sitting idle waiting for passengers to arrive. Cyclone would rank 178 out of 179 wooden roller coasters in a 2006 poll, and its fate was sealed. On January 23, 2007, Magic Mountain announced the ride would close to make way for future expansion, the ride having last operated the prior year. The trains from Cyclone would be transferred to Colossus and were run backwards as part of the park's Halloween events. The plot that was left vacant following Cyclone's demolition was used for another wooden ride. In 2009, Terminator Salvation, the ride would open. This Great Coasters International attraction would eventually be renamed Apocalypse. Becoming the first ride of its type in the world, Freefall opened in June of 1982. Freefall was a first-generation Intamin drop tower and was unlike any roller coaster or thrill ride that had come before. The ride was marketed as simulating falling from the edge of a 10-story building and claimed the ride was designed to simulate what skydivers experience when falling from a plane. Freefall was located at the rear of Magic Mountain in the Monterey Landing Park area. The tan and orange tower featured a track on its front that curved from vertical to horizontal. Reaching a height of 131 feet, it could be seen from most areas in the back of the park, and guests would see one of the eight cars periodically dropping down the front of the tower. Those brave enough to ride would enter one of those four passenger ride cars in a single row and were secured with over-the-shoulder restraints. Cars then moved backwards out of the station. They progressed in groups of three and waited to enter the lift shaft. Once in the lift, it would raise similar to an elevator, reaching a height of 131 feet in 7.2 seconds. At the top, a brief pause allowed riders to take in the view of the park and the ride track stretching out below. The car slid forward into the drop shaft, where it would pause for a few seconds. Without warning, the car would freefall down the shaft, reaching speeds of 55 miles per hour. Near the base, the track curved, levelling out and leaving passengers on their back staring skyward. They would then enter a lower track, where they would be flipped upright and proceed backwards into the station. In 1992, Freefall received a new aqua colour scheme as part of the area's transformation into the movie district. It would again receive a repaint in 1998, with the opening of the Riddler's Revenge to take on an industrial red and white. By the turn of the millennium, newer style drop towers had begun to be introduced at parks around the world, and Freefall was beginning to show its age. Starting in 2005, the ride would barely operate, except on peak days. It would ultimately close in 2007 and be removed in February the next year. The plot where the tower once stood now sits empty, located within the layout of the Riddler's Revenge. Opening on May 29, 1971, Logjammer was one of the original 33 attractions that premiered at Magic Mountain. Located close to the main entrance, at the edge of Whitewater Lake, Logjammer was a log flume type ride and upon its debut was the longest in the United States. Logjammer would feature a layout that used the natural topography of the park, leading to a unique ride experience. Originally opening with a somewhat exposed layout, over the years the landscaping would grow to give the attraction a more secluded feel. Guests wanting to ride would board one of the log-shaped boats in a dual loading station. Once dispatched, the logs rounded a curve and passed over a small lake before engaging with the conveyor for the ride's first lift hill. Boats would then wind themselves around the summit of the mountain, interacting with the track of Gold Rusher at points. Passing under Metro, a second lift would raise guests to the attraction's highest point, while riders enjoyed a view of the nearby Sky Tower. At the top, a loop of trough would deliver boats to the first of Logjammer's drops, racing downwards and entering a slow slaloming section. The ride's main drop would approach, and boats plunged downwards towards the soaking splashdown. A slow float through Whitewater Lake followed as boats returned to the station. Logjammer was so much of a success at the then new park that a second flume ride was added in 1972. Jetstream would be located on the opposite side of the mountain and featured a pair of side-by-side drops. After 40 years of operation, Logjammer closed on October 31, 2011. The park stated that it would be removed for a new attraction, that it would eventually be revealed as Full Throttle. The building that once housed the queue and station for Logjammer can still be seen in the park today. Added to Magic Mountain in 2001 was Deja Vu. This inverted shuttle coaster towered over the Cyclone Bay park area. Its bright green track and blue supports added a splash of colour next to the older wooden ride Cyclone. Deja Vu was a giant inverted boomerang model from manufacturer Vekoma. Vekoma had premiered the original boomerang in 1984, offering a thrilling inverting roller coaster that could be installed on a small plot and was cheaper to construct than other larger layouts. More recently, they had debuted the Invertigo model, taking the original boomerang design and updating it with inverted track and trains. This concept was further enhanced with the giant inverted boomerang, retaining the inverted track, but increasing the size and making the two lift hill spikes vertical. Deja Vu was the first of this new coaster type and opened on August 25, 2001. The two vertical spikes reached a height of 194 feet, making it the tallest inverted roller coaster in the world. The ride's top speed of 65.6 miles per hour also made it the fastest, ensuring that Magic Mountain had something extremely marketable, helping to distract from the delays prototype coaster X was experiencing. Guests would enter the queue line below one of the massive inversions as they passed under the attraction's marquee sign. The line itself would snake around the edge of the coaster, its length designed due to the ride's poor theoretical capacity of only 870 riders per hour. Once they reached the station, guests would board the single 32-passenger train. The train featured a staggered four-across seating configuration, with the two outside seats of each row situated behind the centre two. Seats themselves were similar to those found on Vekoma's other inverted roller coasters. Once dispatched, trains engaged with a catch car and were raised backwards up one of the vertical spikes. Riders would be facing downward for most of the climb before they were suddenly released. Dropping downwards, trains would pick up speed and race through the station. Pulling upwards, they would reach the 110-foot Cobra Roll, inverting twice in quick succession. Speeding downwards again, riders headed towards the station before pulling skyward into a 102-foot tall vertical loop. This loop would lead to the second vertical spike. Trains would lose momentum, riders on their back facing the sky. A second catch car would lift trains even higher before being released. This time riders would negotiate the layout backwards, travelling through the vertical loop and Cobra Roll again. They would slow on the first vertical spike and the catch car would lower them back to the station. The new installation would prove popular with Magic Mountain visitors. However, problems with the second catch car would leave the coaster prone to valleying between the tower and vertical loop. Six Flags had ordered four of the models for their parks, and issues began to manifest on the other installations. The coasters were closed while modifications were made, and these worked to improve reliability. In 2011, it was revealed that Six Flags New England planned to install a giant inverted boomerang. It was subsequently revealed that this would be a relocated Deja Vu. The coaster would give its last rides on October 16, 2011, before being moved to its new home. It would open at the New England Park as Goliath in May 2012. As part of the move, Goliath would receive new trains, in a more traditional four-across layout. Goliath would operate until 2019, before being demolished in 2021. Another opening day attraction, the Sky Tower has been a Magic Mountain landmark throughout the park's history. Construction on the tower began in 1970, and it reached its full height a number of months before Magic Mountain's debut. Originally featuring a yellow colour scheme, the Sky Tower stands 385 foot high and was constructed out of 460 tonnes of steel. The lattice structure was designed to withstand 100 mile per hour winds, and it survived the San Fernando earthquake in 1971. Upon opening, a pair of elevators would take guests to the twin hexagonal observation decks at the top of the tower. The upper deck featured panoramic windows, while the lower level was open, offering guests the opportunity to feel the breeze while they took in the views. The colour scheme would change over the years, with the Sky Tower sporting white and rainbow paintwork. Eventually, the current red was decided on, matching the wider Samurai Summit area. In the late 1970s, the tower was even sponsored by Western Airlines, with advertising featured at the top of the observation deck and a logo partway up the tower. The Sky Tower would close in 2000, however, would be refurbished and reopened to coincide with the debut of Tatsu in 2006. 2 years later, further enhancements came. The Magic of the Mountain Museum was installed at the top, and guests would find memorabilia from the park's history, including an original car from Colossus and a Scream test seat. Despite these updates, the Sky Tower would again close unexpectedly in 2014. The attraction's elevators did not meet the state of California's safety requirements, and a multi-million dollar refurbishment would be required to bring the aging lifts up to code. Rumours suggest that plans are being considered to undertake this work. However, the Sky Tower remains non-operational, acting only as a visual icon for the park. Since its debut in 1971, Magic Mountain had been slowly expanding. In 1976, it had opened the Great American Revolution, the first modern roller coaster to feature a vertical loop. For 1978, the park wanted a new standout attraction. A wooden roller coaster was chosen to add the rumble and sway that was missing from modern steel rides. Constructed at a cost of $7 million, Colossus was marketed as the tallest and fastest roller coaster in the world. Despite being a dubious claim, it was the tallest in California and would remain the tallest roller coaster in the state until the opening of Viper in 1990. Colossus was a twin-track racing coaster, and upon its opening on June 29, 1978, its white structure towered over the park and adjacent parking lot. The ride was heavily marketed and featured on many television segments, reporters eager to climb aboard and present a segment from the roller coaster itself. Riders would choose their side and board one of the 24 passenger trains, secured by a lap bar. After a slow crawl up the lift hill, riders would enter the 115-foot first drop, racing downwards, shadowed by a train on the adjacent track. Pulling upwards, they would enter a turnaround, lining up with the second drop, speeding through a bunny hill and rising in a double up. Another turnaround would deliver riders to the third drop, that was quickly followed by the ride's double dip hill. Rising once more, a final turnaround would line up with a number of airtime hills, before the brakes. Despite a strong reception, Colossus suffered from extensive downtime in its first year. The roller coaster was closed in May 1979 to receive reprofiling and new trains, reopening in December of the same year. Modifications would continue, receiving a third set of trains in 1987 and a removal of the double dip in 1991. The issues would not prevent the ride becoming an icon for the park, and it would feature in numerous films and television shows over the years. During 2014, Six Flags announced that Colossus would close, indicating it would reopen the following year as Twisted Colossus. The renovation would be undertaken by Rocky Mountain Construction and would utilise a revolutionary I-beam track. RMC had received notoriety in the industry for transforming aging wooden rides into thrilling hybrid coasters, and Colossus had been a prime target for this treatment. The racing element was retained, but both tracks combined into a Mobius loop, increasing the ride duration, as well as incorporating inversions and more thrilling profiling into the layout. The renovation saw new life given to the classic wooden coaster, with Twisted Colossus still operating to this day. Green Lantern First Flight was the new coaster for 2011 at Magic Mountain, and opened in July that year. The addition of this ride had been leaked in October the prior year, and was subsequently confirmed by the park itself. Scheduled to be built in a newly themed section, Green Lantern opened in DC Universe, a rename of the earlier Gotham City backlot. The roller coaster itself was a Zaxpin model, from manufacturer Intamin, and was the first of its kind in the United States. Designed in response to the earlier Aerodynamics fourth dimension ride type. Instead of a large custom layout with controlled rotation of seats, Intamin's new model stacked the track vertically, taking up an extremely small piece of land. The seats on this new coaster type featured uncontrolled spinning, leading to a differing experience every ride. After numerous delays, Green Lantern First Flight opened on July 1st, allowing Six Flags Magic Mountain to take the world record for the most roller coasters in a single park, at 18. visitors were greeted by a towering track structure, finished in a deep green. The track itself was only in the vertical plane, creating an almost wall-like appearance to the ride. Part of the queue was inside, featuring lightly themed rooms, before riders were split and sent to different sides of the attraction. Trains sat 8 guests, 4 on each side. Seats were arranged back to back, with 2 facing forwards and 2 facing backwards. Over-the-shoulder restraints secured riders before trains were dispatched. The lift hill was arranged vertically and trains seemed to lock in unusual angles based on the weight distribution of those on board. At the top, trains began their descent, zigzagging lower and lower. Trains were free to spin, somersaulting riders head over heels depending on the distribution of passengers. Green Lantern ended with its most intense moment, flipping the riders up and over a steep curve. Initial reviews were generally positive, praising the ride's intense and compact layout and stating it was a solid addition to Six Flags Magic Mountain. As the ride settled into its operation, mechanical issues became apparent and trains would occasionally become stuck, reportedly with guests upside down. As a solution, modifications were made, with trains receiving additional metal around the star-shaped design. The results were a heavier train, less likely to rotate. This modification meant the riders negotiated some of the attraction's tighter curves without inverting, leading to fast and uncomfortable transitions. Guests complained of a painful ride experience due to the now forceful and jerky turns. The number of negative reviews would grow, with Green Lantern First Flight reaching a legendary status due to how bad it was. The roller coaster would close unexpectedly in July of 2017, remaining non-operational, and in 2019, Six Flags confirmed it would not reopen. It will begin deconstruction later that year to be transferred to sister park La Ronde, ready for opening the following year. Construction was paused due to the COVID-19 pandemic, with the project being cancelled in 2022. The site where Green Lantern First Flight had sat remained empty for a number of years, before becoming part of the plot for Wonder Woman Flight of Courage in 2022. The former station for Green Lantern was repurposed for the new single rail coaster. For more than 50 years, Six Flags Magic Mountain has entertained and thrilled generations of families. From groundbreaking coasters like Shockwave and Flashback, to beloved classics like Logjammer and Colossus, these attractions helped shape the park's legacy. While visitors can no longer experience these lost rides, their influence lives on, sparking the memories of those that visit.